A critical attribute of a well-engineered software product is maintainability. Briefly discuss two other attributes of well-engineered software. All right, so using a language that is made for the solution type, dependability, literally. All right, so tested using multiple testing strategies, portability, you can put portability to documented as internal documentation. Explain given two reasons why it's important to involve end users and management and developer development of software. So does that explain two reasons why it appears because it needs some. All right, so two people are talking about end users and management. So we could basically break up into end users and management. End users, they would know exactly what problems they have the software and give deals. And management would see exactly what they want from the actual software. Right, cool. Explain why a software system that's using a real environment must be upgraded to become progressively useful. Alright, older software can come obsolete because business practices change or hardware become complex, therefore software will need to adapt. Alright, that's good. Alright, generating letters. Yes, if you have generating letters, that would be okay. Once it comes from the outcome, like the process for the outcome is, that process will send the information to the generate the letters data store and send it to the person. Yeah, that would be cool. Add down. So basically what would happen is that the person would send in their application. When they send in the application, you have a thing that would say process application, which is basically take all the data from the file, from the application, and then they would take that information and store it in the application's file folder, right? In the data store. From there, the shortlisting process now will pull the application info from the application's file to shortlist the people. And if it shortlists a person, it will send the date and time for that to the person for when the interview will be. Once it sends the date and time, it will update the status on the application's file to be somebody that has gotten an interview. And then it will send a successful applicant to the interview process. The interview process now is going to do the interview and take the applicant's info and put it inside the personnel file, because now they are an actual employee. Yeah, successful applicants go into the personnel file. And since this person is not an employee of the organization, right? Finally, letters are sent to each applicant informing his or her of the outcome. So the outcome would have been stored by the update status. So the application status now would go to a function called application outcome sender. That's what I named it, which will now send the letter to the person. So yeah, that would be the answer. All right, so I must admit, I'm not entirely sure how they mark data flow diagrams. All I could guess is that for each process, they would give you a mark. For each data store, they would give you a mark. For each arrow, they'll give you a mark, but sometimes they have more things than the amount of marks, and it's totally logical. So I'm not too sure, but I guarantee you, if you have less, you will get the 14 marks. So if you have more than 14 things, you basically should get the marks based on logic. But how they decide to mark it, because our data flow diagram could get marked in so many different ways. So, two deliverables of the analysis phase of software engineering are feasibility study and a requirement specification. Right, state two reasons why the feasibility study was undertaken. Right, two reasons here. Feasibility studies are carried out to determine economic viability and to determine the risks associated with carrying out the project. Right, describe the contents of the requirement specification document. Probably like the needs of the user. Okay, so the needs of the users as it pertains to their expectations for solving the problem they have. I guess that's enough gas there to make that question work. The needs of the users, which is one, and take into consideration their expectations and solve any problem, that would be the requirement specification. I see it as a 2-mark question, but how they get any 3 marks, they not too sure. So probably add it by example. You know, we love to use examples to fill our answers. Example, the speed of the system will increase. Yeah. Okay, that's cool. What say ye? Alright, a certain organization consists of a number of departments. Each department employs one or more employees, but an employee is employed in only one department. The organization stores the first name, last name, address, and telephone number of each employee, as well as an employee number to uniquely identify each employee. Employees have one or more skills. The department undertakes various kinds of projects. Employees may be assigned to one or more projects being undertaken. A project consists of a set of tasks and employees. So there's an ERD. ERDs are very cakeish because it's basically lay out everything for you. So let's start from the top. There is a... It contains a number of departments. So a certain organization. Now when they say a certain organization, the organization itself is not an entity, because you're drawing the entity relationship diagram for the organization. So don't make the mistake and put like a entity as organization has many departments. You'll probably miss the bus. So we have departments. What does the department have in it? The department employs employees. So one department employs one or more employees, but an employee is employed in one department. So our department, in our nice little diamond here, we put the word employees. One department employs many employees. Right. The organization stores the first name, last name, address, and telephone number of each employee. So we just put those things there. F name. L name. Address. Telephone number. Telephone number. Nice. And employee number. Forgot employee number. EMP num. Alright, employees have one or more skills. Well, skills being an entity, kind of weird. Employee has. Has is always like one of the easiest verbs to use. Employee has one or more skills, so you could put the one or more line there. One or more skills. Our department undertakes various kinds of projects. Employees maybe, so various kinds of projects. Department here, project here. Nice verb here will be does. Department employs many projects. Ta-da! The department undertakes various kinds of projects. Employees may be assigned to one or more projects being undertaken. So an employee may be assigned to one or more projects. Should put is assigned. Assigned. To employee assigned to one or more projects, and a project consists of a set of tasks and employees use one or more of their skills when performing tasks. What tasks now? A project consists of a set of tasks. Task is an attribute of project. No. Yeah. It sounds like task is an attribute of projects. A project has one or more tasks. A project consists of a set of tasks and employees use one or more of their skills when performing tasks on a project. So, an employee, you use one or more skills. So, one or more skills are used when doing a task. That looks like it there. Mm-hmm. All right, 14 marks. Not again, 14 marks. Yeah, let's see. To get 14 marks, they would have to give you 1 mark for each entity. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Each relation, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Attributes, every 2 attributes, 12, 13, and 14. Oh no, the employee number has to be, you gotta underline the employee number to show as the primary key. So you gotta underline employee number. Alright, consider a function lsearch which accepts the following parameters. We're accepting the array n and a key. Is a linear search? Okay. And performs a linear search on if the key is found, the function returns the location where it was found, otherwise it returns minus one. Alright, this is a question is asked all the time, but I like this question kinda weird. So you're basically coming up with a test for how this would work. So the first thing you would do is you would send full array with the number to be found and a correct key, and it should return the location of the number. All right, so that's one test. Test number two, you would send an empty array with no number to be found, and it should return minus one. And then you're sending a full array with numbers to be found, but a wrong key, it should return minus one.